إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. And before we start, inshallah ta'ala, a reminder from myself and everyone, don't miss sunnat al-isha, inshallah. Don't miss sunnat al-isha. There is 2 rak'ah after salatul isha, part of the 12 rak'ah sunnah al-ratiba that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam used to be consistently praying it, 2 before fajr, 4 before dhuhr, 2 after dhuhr, 2 after maghrib, and 2 after isha. So if it's not prayed after the salah, either after the dars at home, and in general, it's always recommended to pray the sunan or the nawafil at home. The topic is examples of the tawakkul of the sahaba radiallahu anhum upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is a huge subject, and the life of the sahaba radiallahu anhum was all upon or about establishing the tawakkul on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And adding to what has been mentioned before, since at-tawakkul, to rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is the highest level of the tawheed, is how to perfect the tawheed and the oneness of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is by perfecting at-tawakkul upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the sahaba radiallahu anhum, of course, they are the generation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfected and made them the example for those who come after them. والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار والذين اتبعوهم بإحسان رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه. Foremost of the مهاجرين and the أنصار and those who followed them with إحسان. So to follow them with إحسان, with goodness, these are the ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with, and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And as we heard the ayah about when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم and to this ummah, إن ينصركم الله فلا غالب لكم وإن يخذلكم فمن ذا الذي ينصركم من بعده وعلى الله فليتوكل المؤمنون, which means if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you victory, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you aid and support and help, no one can let you down whatsoever. إن ينصركم الله فلا غالب لكم, no one can defeat you if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to make you victorious. وإن يخذلكم, and al-khudlan is when someone is let down, when someone has hope in someone but he let him down, and which means if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not give you support and help, فَمَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَنْصُرُكُمْ مِنْ بَعْدِ, who else would aid you and help you other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No one, since everything is by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And therefore upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala فليتوكل المؤمنون, upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let the believers put their trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how the verses, how the words of the Quran is in such a way that it makes the matter very clear, and not to leave any room for anything else. Even the end of the verse, وَعَلَى اللَّهِ, means upon Allah. فَلْيَتَوَكَّلْ, put their, this is in the present tense, that means it's constantly there. Let them rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, meaning, and then the believers are mentioned. So when they translate it, they don't put it in that order because it doesn't make sense like that in English, I guess. So they would say, and upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, let the believers rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But the order of the words to show the importance of what is being mentioned here, to establish the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one thing I wanted to mention here, inshallah we won't take more than half an hour, 35 minutes or something like that, inshallah, is as one of the early generations of Islam, when he defined al-khudlan. Al-khudlan, as mentioned in the verse, أَيَنْصُرْكُمُ اللَّهُ فَلَا غَالِبَ لَكُمْ, if Allah give you victory and support you and help you, no one can defeat you. وَأَنْ يَخْذُلْكُمْ, the word mentioned here, يَخْذُلْكُمْ, from al-khudlan, when someone is let down, when someone is not being helped, when someone is not helped. What is the meaning of it? As some of the early generations of Islam, he said, according to this context of the verse, he says, أَنْ يَكِلَكَ اللَّهُ إِلَى غَيْرِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make you rely upon other than Him. That's the khudlan. That's the loss. That's the defeat. When a person rely upon other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, This is the real loss that we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect us from it. There are so many verses in the Quran, of course, that talks about the tawakkul and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and the hadith that we also heard earlier about the 70,000 those who would enter the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without reckoning, without hisab. Their utmost or the characteristics that bring them, bring all the characteristics together is وَعَلَى رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. They upon the Lord يَتَوَكَّلُونَ. They rely upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's why, like any other act of worship, people are in levels with it. The same way the salah that we prayed, not everybody is the same. As the Prophet said, إِنَّ الْعَبْدَ لَيَنْصَرِفُ مِنْ صَلَاتِهِ. A person finishes the salah and only 1/10 is written for him of the reward. 1/9, 1/8, 1/7, 1/6, 1/5, 1/4, 1/3, 1/2. The physical actions are the same, but the rewards are given according to how much. As Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he said the khushu', the devotion in the salah, the presence of the heart in the salah, and also according to one's iman, and the iman increases and decreases, increases with the good deeds and decreases with the bad deeds. So since at-tawakkul is amalul qalb, is a deed done by the heart, it is not a physical action, it's a deed done by the heart. The heart has to fully rely upon Allah, and the heart has to rely on something. If it's not relying upon Allah, it would rely upon other than Allah. And this is the khudlan. This is the defeat. This is the loss. And if the heart, if we can assume, if it's correct to say that, if it's 50%, then it's going to be filled with another 50% that is relying upon other than Allah. It has to be filled. That portion, if it's correct to say that, if there's a portion in the heart that's supposed to rely upon something, if it's not filled with relying upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it would rely upon other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is again the defeat in this life. So our job is to establish the tawakkul ala Allah tawaraka wa ta'ala, which is the i'timadul qalbi ala Allah. The heart is relying upon Allah while taking the means. And whoever doesn't take the means, he has problem with his own reason and intellect. He's insane. He's not mukallaf. If he thinks that way, nobody does. Meaning have sanity. So we're not questioning taking the means, of course. But the heart is relying upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, while of course taking the permissible means, because the haram means, it doesn't make sense that someone would take a haram mean and he's relying upon Allah. It doesn't make sense that way when it comes to matters of deen. And there's so many things to be mentioned about at-tawakkul, and maybe we should constantly, inshallah ta'ala, establish this ibadah in our hearts, because they will constantly try to make you rely upon other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The shaitan, this is one of his objectives. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا ذَلِكُمُ الشَّيْطَانُ يُخَوِّفُ أَوْلِيَاءَ فَلَا تَخَافُهُمْ وَخَافُونِي. Shaitan, he keeps making you fear his awliya, his supporters and helpers and so on. فَلَا تَخَافُهُمْ وَخَافُونِي إِن كُنْتُمْ مُؤْمِنِينَ. Do not fear them and fear me. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala if you are believers. Very briefly, I wanted to mention an example, and there are many examples, and that by the example it shows there are so many examples in the life of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, but one of which was in the battle of Dhat al-Riqa', the battle of Dhat al-Riqa'. And I didn't check or to see what's a good word to use for Dhat al-Riqa', but maybe you guys can help me with that. That's the name of the Ghazwa. This is the name of the battle that the Prophet والسلام, fought with the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And there was something before it and something during that battle. But it's called Dhat al-Riqa' because of, as the Sahabi radiallahu anhu, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari. And I'm quoting from the hadith in Bukhari and others. When he said, خَرَجْنَا مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَنَحْنُ سِتَّةَ نَفَرْ بَيْنَنَا بَعِيرٌ نَعْتَقِبُ. We went out with the Prophet والسلام, every six, they have a ba'ir or a mount that they take turns to ride on it. And this was a long travel to go against their enemies. فَنَقَبَتْ أَقْدَمُنَا. So our foot, نَقَبَتْ, that means it swelled and it had pus and things like that as a result of the long walking barefoot. Without even having means or things to wear, they would walk. They walked for a long period of time, and they're not all riding on animals. He says, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhu, وَسَقَطَتْ أَظْفَارِي. my toenails fell. Can you imagine how long walking that it end up with their nails falling? His nail fell from his toes. فَكُنَّا نَلُفُّ عَلَىٰ أَرْجُلِنَا الْخِرَقِ. We would wrap our foot with khiraq. Khiraq is pieces of cloth. The pieces of cloth that is does not make a shirt or anything, just torn pieces of cloth. They would wrap their foot with it. فَسُمِّيَتْ ذَاتُ الرِّقَاعِ. Then the battle was called ذَاتُ الرِّقَاعِ because of the riqa'. الرِّقَاعِ is a plural of a riqa'a or a piece of cloth. So it was called the battle of the pieces of cloth that they were wrapping their foot with because of what happened to them. في سبيل الله, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لِمَا كُنَّا نَعْصِبُ الْخِرَقْ عَلَىٰ أَرْجُلِنَا. Because we used to, or we were wrapping the khiraq upon our legs and our foot. And when you see the life of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum from the time of Mecca, when they were weak and oppressed by the disbelievers and tortured and so on, and then after they migrated with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and their life with the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, from one challenge to the other, from one trial to the other, never complained, never said when this is going to happen, when's that going to happen. And with them is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They understood exactly what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from them, and they enjoyed the fact that they are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this was what the ghazwa, or what the battle was called. The reason why this, the battle of that al-Riqa', which is important of course to study the seerah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, it came after the haditha or the incident of Bi'r Ma'una. Bi'r Ma'una, it's a name of a well, but there was a very sad situation that happened where the Sahaba radiallahu anhu, Anas radiallahu anhu, he said, فَمَا رَأَيْتُ. After that, what that happened, he says, فَمَا رَأَيْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ سَلَّمَ وَجَدَ عَلَى شَيْءٍ مَا وَجَدَ عَلَيْهِ. He said, I've never seen the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, wajada means from al-huzn, from the grief. I've never seen him in state of grief and sadness like I saw him after what happened in the incident of Bi'r Ma'un. What was the incident of Bi'r Ma'una? 70 of the Huffaz of the Quran from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they were killed in a betrayal, in khiyana. As Anas also radiallahu anhu, he said, جَاءَ أُنَاسٌ إِلَى النَّبِيِّ عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. People came to the Prophet عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ. فَقَالُوا بَعَثْ مَعَنَا رِجَالًا يُعَلِّمُونَ الْقُرْآنَ وَالسُّنَّةِ. They said to the Prophet عَلَيْهِ الصَّلَاةُ وَالسَّلَامُ, send with us men that would teach us the Quran and the Sunnah. See, the Quran and the Sunnah is mentioned here. It's not something invented later, right? For them to teach us the Quran and the Sunnah, they understood that early. Even these people were disbelievers, but they trying to deceive the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, saying, send with us men that would teach us the Quran and the Sunnah. فبعث إليهم سبعين رجلا من الأنصار. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام sent with them 70 from the Ansar, from the people of Al-Ansar, from Al-Madinah. يقال لهم القراء. They are known by القراء. And we know what the قراء means. Those who memorize the Quran, they are experts in the Quran. Anas radiallahu anhu, he says, فيهم خالي حرام. His uncle, his name is Haram. He was among them. يقرؤون القرآن. They, يقرؤون is not reciting the Quran only. That means they are well versed in the Quran. ويتدارسونه بالليل. And they study during the night. So they're busy with the Quran day and night. وكانوا بالنهار يجيئون بالماء. These 70, they used to come during the day. They bring the water. فيضعونه في المسجد. And they would put it in the masjid. ويحتطبون فيبيعونه. And they would cut wood and they would sell it. ويشترون به الطعام. And they would purchase with the wood food لأهل الصفة والفقراء. They would purchase food with what they've earned from selling the wood to the people of As-Suffa, the poor people at the back of the masjid of the Prophet ﷺ, and the poor ones. This is how virtue and people of the Quran and so on. فَبَعَثَهُمُ النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. The Prophet ﷺ sent them. فَتَعَرَّضُوا لَهُمْ فَقَتَلُوهُمْ. They killed them. قَبْلَ أَن يَبْلُغُوا الْمَكَانِ. Before they reached their place, they were all killed. So فقالوا, so they said, these حفاظ, they said before they died, اللهم أبلغ عنا نبينا أن قد لقيناك فرضينا عنك ورضيت عنا. They said, O Allah, convey to our prophet that we had met you, O Allah, and you are pleased with us and we are pleased with you. This is of course after they died. So they said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, inform our prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that we had met you and you are pleased with us and we are pleased with you. And in that, even in itself, as some of the ulama, they said, you see how much is the love of the sahaba to the prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. After they were martyred and they received this pleasure from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the shaheed is the only one that wants to come back to this dunya, to this worldly life, so that he can die again as a shaheed, as a martyr. But as some said, but because the Prophet ﷺ, they didn't want him to grieve or to be sad for what happened to them, they said, O Allah, أبلغ نبينا, inform our Prophet that we had met you, return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and فَرَضِينَ عَنْكَ وَرَضِيْتَ عَنَّا, we are pleased with you, O Allah, and you're pleased with us. So the Prophet ﷺ, immediately the wahi came to the Prophet ﷺ. But in the hadith, قَلْ فَأَتَ رَجُلْ حَرَامًا, a man came to Haram, the uncle of Anas radiallahu anhu, min khalfih, from behind him. فَطَعَنَهُ بِرُمْحِهِ حَتَّى أَنْفَذَهُ, he stabbed him with his rumh, with his spear, till أَنْفَذَهُ, till the spear came out from the other side. فقال حرام radiallahu anhu, he said, فُزْتُ وَرَبِّ الْكَعْبِ, فُزْتُ, I attained the greatest win by the Lord of the Kaaba. Imagine someone, this is the words that comes out of his mouth when he is stabbed, knowing for sure that he is dying. He said, فُزْتُ وَرَبِّ الْكَعْبِ. So, فَقَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ لِأَصْحَابِهِ, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, far distance from them, sitting with his companions, he said, إِنَّ إِخْوَانَكُمْ الَّذِينَ قُتِلُوا قَالُوا لِرَبِّهِمْ بَلِّغْ عَنَّا نَبِيَّنَا إِنْ أَنَّا قَدْ لَقِنَاكَ فَرَضِينَ عَنْكَ وَرَضِيْتَ عَنَّا. He said, your brothers, those who died, they said to the Lord, O Allah, بَلِّغْ عَنَّا نَبِيِّكَ, convey to our prophet that we had met you, and فَرَضِينَ عَنْكَ وَرَضِيْتَ عَنَّا, and we are pleased with you and you are pleased with us. So the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, this has affected the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام so much, and this is right after that where the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام would make the qunut, the dua in the obligatory salah upon these tribes, those who killed the 70 of the qurra, as it's reported in Bukhari and Muslim. Also from Anas radiallahu anhu, he said that أن رعلاً وذكوان وعصية وبني لحيان, these are the tribes, those who did this betrayal, and they are the ones that asked for the 70 qurra from the Ansar. So the Prophet والسلام, afterwards he made dua against them for an entire month. And this dua actually in the Fard Salah, this is valid of course at the times of major incidences like that, but not just in Fajr, in the five daily Salah, the obligatory Salah after coming up from the Ruku'. So then after that it was the battle of Dhat al-Riqa'. And this is what we heard about it. And there's more than one thing that happened in this battle that it shows, again, you know, with all of these difficulties that they had to face, their life was a pleasant one because of the hearts relying upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said when He commanded them to say, قُلْ هَلْ تَرَبَّصُونَ بِنَا إِلَّا إِحْدَى الْحُسْنَيْنِ. Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to them, say to the disbelievers, هَلْ تَرَبَّصُونَ بِنَا, are you waiting for us anything but one of the two حُسْنَيَيْن, to afflict us, one of the two good things, which is either to be victorious or to attain a shahada or martyrdom. Their life was like this, to make the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala superior. One of the ahadith that is, you probably heard it when the subject of at-tawakkul is mentioned, it's something that happened right after this battle when they were coming back. And by the way, there was no fight. They went for this long walk and they were going to the tribe of Ghatafan, going to their place. It's not like their people will come out to fight them. And they were, it was said they were 400 only of the companions radiallahu anhum going to the people in their place. And they're much more in their numbers and so on. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threw the fear in the hearts of the enemies and they said, we can't do this. And they basically, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, won the battle without a fight. But they went through this suffering and this patience with what happened to them in the battle. On the way back, two things or two incidents that shows the tawakkul upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, in the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the famous hadith that it was said, Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu anhu, he said, كنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. We were with the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام بذات الرقاع, in the battle of that الرقاع. فإذا أتينا على شجرة ظليلة, if we go by a tree that is shady and nice, تركناها للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, we would leave it to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم to rest under the tree. فجاء رجل من المشركين, a man from the مشركين came, وسيف النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم معلق بالشجرة. And the sword of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was hanging on the tree while he was sleeping عليه الصلاة والسلام. فاخترطه, this Arabi, he took the sword then he took it out. فقال, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was awakened then. So this mushrik, this disbeliever, he said to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام with the sword open like this, and the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام laying down and he's standing, this mushrik, this disbeliever, he said, تخافني, do you fear me? The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, لا, no. He said, فمن يمنعك مني, who then would protect you from me, who would prevent me from killing you basically, he said, Allah. So the narrator says, فتهدده أصحاب النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وأقيمة الصلاة. Another narration that the sword fell from his hand. When the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, Allah, the sword fell from the hand of this disbeliever. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام took the sword and he said, من يمنعك مني, who now will protect you from me? So he asked for his life and the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام did not harm him whatsoever, and the hadith goes on afterwards. So this was one thing that shows the tawakkul of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. And of course the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام is سيد المتوكلين, the best of all the متوكلين ever is Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم, they understood that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهُ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرِ, indeed you have in the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام the best example. They saw the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, how he acts and what does he say, and he acted upon what he say and what the Quran is talking about, the tawakkul and all these different qualities. So they of course were the best of this ummah in this. One last incident also that is mentioned in the battle of that الرقاع, that Jabir also ibn Abdullah, he said, خرجنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم في غزوة ذات الرقاع. We were in the battle of ذات الرقاع. من نخل فأصاب رجل. Some incident happened, so one of them, to make it short, one of the disbelievers after they were coming back, the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم, he followed them, hiding where they're going, and he's going with them, but from a distance so that they don't see him. So then the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام نزل منزلا, when they're traveling, so they wanted to rest overnight and to sleep. فقال, so the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, من رجل يكلأنا ليلتنا هذه, who among you would guard us on this night? The guards, those who would guard them, they would sleep, so who would take care of us this night? فانتدب رجل من المهاجرين ورجل من الأنصار. One man from the مهاجرين and one man from the أنصار is to take that job. And it was said that it was عمار بن ياسر رضي الله عنه and عباد بن بشر. عمار بن ياسر from the مهاجرين and عباد بن بشر from the أنصار. فقال, so they both says, نحن يا رسول الله, us, O messenger of Allah. So they stayed by فم الشعب, by the place where anyone, if they want to come, they would come through that place. And the people in the valley, they are sleeping. قال وكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قد نزلوا إلى الشعب من الوادي. So when they went, the Ansari said to the مهاجري, عباد بن بشر said to عمار بن ياسر, أي الليل أحب إليك أن أكفيكه أوله أو آخرة؟ Which part of the night you want me to take care of first? The first part of the night or the second part? That means one sleep, taking shifts and who's sleep and who's going to guard. قال بل اكفيني أوله. Then take care of the first part of the night and I'll sleep. قال فالضجع المهاجري, the مهاجري slept, فنام. He laid down and he slept. وقام الأنصاري, عباد بن بشر stood up, يصلي. He stood up, يصلي, making salah. And this man came, the disbeliever. فا فرماه بسهم فوضعه فيه. He shot him with an arrow and it hit him. It hit عباد بن بشر while he was making صلاة. قال فنزعه فوضعه. He took it out and he threw it on the floor while he is making صلاة. وثبت قائما يصلي. And he continued firmly standing in the salah. So nowadays if just someone a loud noise comes in the salah, may Allah forgive us. وثبت قائما يصلي. ثم رماه بسهم آخر فوضعه فيه. Then he shot another arrow on him and it hit him. قال فنزعه فوضعه. He took it out and he threw it away. وثبت قائما يصلي. And he continued firmly making the salah. ثم عاد له الثالثة فوضعه فيه. The third time he did the same thing. فنزعه فوضعه. And he took it out and he continued. But then this after the third one. ثم ركع وسجد. He made ركوع and then سجود. ثم أهب صاحبها. Then he woke up his friend, his companion عمار بن ياسر. فقال اجلس فقد أثبت. He said sit, I've been hit. فوثب. So he stood up. Of course he woke up in a very strong way quickly. So when the man saw them both, he ran away, the disbeliever. So when Al-Muhajiri, when Ammar ibn Yasir saw what happened to the Ansari and he's in blood, he's bleeding, he said, Subhanallah, أَفَلَا أَهْبَبْتَنِي أَوَّلَ مَرَمَكَ. Why didn't you wake me up from the first time that he shot this arrow on you? He says, قَالَ كُنْتُ فِي سُورَةٍ أَقْرَأُهَا فَلَمْ أُحِبَّ أَنْ أَقْطَعَهَا حَتَّى أُنْفِذَهَا. I was reciting a surah that I love to recite and I didn't like to stop the recitation till I finished the surah. This is something that is not, I mean, when someone hears this is not from this earth. Like someone to be in that state of so much occupied with the Quran in that level and of course with the hearts and the strength in the hearts reciting the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he did not want to stop the recitation of the Quran. فلما تاب علي الرمية ركعت فأذنتك. When he kept on, you know, as if it's like a fly or a bug or something, when he kept on, you know, throwing these arrows on me, then I made ركوع and I woke you up. وأيم الله لولا أن أضيع ثغرا أمرني رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بحفظه لقطع نفسي قبل أن أقطعها أنفذها. And listen to what he said. He said, والله, by Allah, if it wasn't that I didn't want to not to honor the thagr or this place or the frontier that the Prophet ﷺ commanded me to protect, this is a duty, this is a trust, he's protecting the entire army. If it wasn't that I would ruin or miss holding fast to what the Prophet ﷺ commanded him to protect, I would rather that he would kill me before I would stop this reciting this surah. I would rather die before finishing reciting the surah. We can reflect upon this for a long period of time. Imagine we're reading Quran and the phone rings. He's being shot at with arrow after the other and he doesn't want to stop reciting the surah. And if it wasn't that the Prophet ﷺ told him to guard this spot, this is the only reason why he stopped. And he knew that it's, you know, someone like this from a distance, he's not of a great harm. He will finish the salah. He wants to finish. But since he kept on throwing it, so let's finish the salah and take care of him. It's amazing. And of course, it shows the level of the hearts of these people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was pleased with them. And they were pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they knew that from the very beginning. It's not something that was news to them. And in the hadith of Bay'atul Aqaba, when they gave the pledge to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and the long hadith of Al-Bay'ah, and I would just mention one part of it. When they met the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, and there were 70 of them, they came to, this is in the Bay'ah, when the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام was in Mecca, and he met the people from Al-Medina, and he presented Al-Islam to them, and they accepted the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when they gave the pledge of Al-Islam, I wanted to get to the point of reference easy, otherwise the hadith is long. So when the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he took from them, when they said, عَلَى مَنْ أُبَيْعُكَ, upon what should we give the pledge to you, O Prophet of Allah? He said, تُبَيْعُونِ عَلَى السَّمْعِ وَالطَّاعَ, to give me the pledge on listening and obeying. في النشاط والكسل, when you're energetic and when you're lazy. وعلى النفقة في العسر واليسر, and to spend when it time when times are tight and when it's ease. وعلى الأمر بالمعروف والنهي عن منكر, and to enjoin good and forbid evil. وعلى أن تقولوا في الله لا تأخذكم فيه لومة لائم, and that you would speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala about the truth. No one or a la'im or a blamer or someone like that would make you compromise speaking the truth. وعلى أن تنصروني إذا قدمت يثرب, and that you would help me if I come to يثرب, which is المدينة. فتمنعوني مما تمنعون منه أنفسكم وأزواجكم وأبناءكم, that you would protect me for the da'wah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, the same way that you protect your family and so on. And he said to them, ولكم الجنة, what in return for us, as it's mentioned in some of the narrations, what is for us in return? He said, لكم الجنة, nothing of the worldly benefit. He says, فقمنا نبيع, we stood up and we gave the pledge to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. The point here is, أسعد ابن زرارة رضي الله عنه, one of the companions of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he's from the Ansar, from those who gave that pledge of بيعة العقبة from المدينة. And أسعد ابن زرارة رضي الله عنه, he was the first one to establish صلاة الجمعة in المدينة. And as كعب بن مالك رضي الله عنه, when he later on he lost his eyesight, every time he goes for جمعة, he makes dua to Asad ibn Zurara. When his son was taking him to the masjid, he hears him making dua to Asad ibn Zurara every time he goes for Jumu'ah. So he said to his father, every time you go for Jumu'ah, I hear you making dua for Asad ibn Zurara. So he said to him, he was the first one that established the Jumu'ah in Al-Madinah. The faithfulness, when someone did a favor to them like this, every Jumu'ah he would go for Jumu'ah, he would make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for him. So Asad ibn Zurara, and he was the youngest among the 70, he said to his people, what did he say to them after they were going to give the pledge to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام? He said, رويداً يا أهل يثرب, take it easy, the people of يثرب, slow down. إِنَّا لَمْ نَضْرِبْ إِلَيْهِ أَكْبَادَ الْمَطِيِّ إِلَّا وَنَحْنُ نَعْلَمُ أَنَّهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ. We did not travel all that distance unless we know, of course, that he's the messenger of Allah. إِنَّ إِخْرَاجَهُ الْيَوْمُ مُفَارَقَةُ الْعَرَبِ كَافَّةَ. For him to be expelled now, meaning from Mecca, that means he is detaching himself from the entire Arab. That means the enmity of the entire Arab will be on you, against you. وَقَتْلُ خِيَارِكُمْ, and the best of you will be killed. وَأَنْ تَعُضَّكُمُ السُّيُوفِ, and the swords will bite you. The swords will bite you. That means he's being explicit here, trying to make sure that they are really truthful. Do you know what you're getting yourself into? Basically, this is what he's saying to them. فَإِمَّا أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ تَصْبِرُونَ عَلَى السُّيُوفِ إِذَا مَسَّتْكُمْ. Either you are people that have patience with the swords if it touches you, وَعَلَى قَتْلِ خِيَارِكُمْ, and that the best of you will be killed, وَعَلَى مُفَرَقَةِ الْعَرَبِ كَافَّةِ, and the Arab, all of them will be your enemies. فَخُذُوهُ وَأَجْرُكُمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. If you're ready for this, take him. And your rewards is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without end. وَإِمَّا أَنْتُمْ قَوْمٌ تَخَافُونَ مِنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ خِيفَةً فَذَرُوا. Or if you're people that you fear for yourself, then leave him alone. فَهُوَ أَعْذَرُ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. This is better for you by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they said, قَالُوا يَا أَسْعَدْ إِبْنَ زُرَارَ أَمِطْ عَنَّا يَدَكْ. Oh أسعد, move your hands away from us. فَوَاللَّهِ لَا نَذَرُ هَذِهِ الْبَيْعَةَ وَلَا نَسْتَخِيرُهَا. We would never let go this bay'ah, this pledge, and we would never return it for anything whatsoever. فقمنا إليه رجلا رجلا. They stood to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, man after the other, ويعطينا على ذلك الجنة, and that he would give us in return the Jannah of Allah سبحانه وتعالى. So صحابة رضي الله عنهم, their life was to make the words of Allah سبحانه وتعالى superior, and that's why Allah سبحانه وتعالى was pleased with them, pleased with Allah سبحانه وتعالى, and whatever the qadr of Allah سبحانه وتعالى that he afflicted them with, they were patient and they were obedient to Allah. Because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevated their levels. And whatever person, in whatever position he's in, we all need to be upon the level of tawakkul upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in whatever situation that we're in. So if a person is safe in his home, in his locality, in his place, to as he mentioned here, أَعْذَرُ لَكُمْ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. The word which is also, I don't know the best translation to it. Maybe someone can look up this translation in the ayah in Surah Al-A'raf. When the people of Bani Israel, when they said, لِمَ تَعِذُونَ قَوْمًا اللَّهُ مُهْلِكُهُمْ أَوْ مُعَذِّبُهُمْ عَذَابًا شَدِيدًا قَالُوا مَعْذِرَةً إِلَى رَبِّكُمْ. How can you translate this one? Why, when they said, when those who were forbidding the evil, the others, they said to them, why would you forbid the evil from for people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish them? They're evil people. Why would you care about advising them and conveying the message to them? So they replied to them, why? For two reasons. قَالُوا مَعْذِرَةً إِلَى رَبِّكُمْ وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ. The second one, وَلَعَلَّهُمْ يَتَّقُونَ. Maybe they will repent to Allah. Maybe they will be among the people of taqwa. But the first one, it's for own self. مَعْذِرَةً إِلَى رَبِّكُمْ. They are so that they're not blamed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that there's no blame come on them. And there is also for the other side, so that they don't come in the day of judgment say, the message didn't reach us. And this is the purpose of the tadhkir, as we heard it also earlier, to remind the people, because the hujjah of Allah has to be established. The evidence from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has to be established, and that's the justice of Allah. And at the same time for the people to elevate their levels. So how can a person be safe from being blamed? Is to do the best he can with whatever means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave the person. So to be obedient to Allah, to repent to Allah, to occupy our time with seeking the knowledge of the deen of Allah, to convey this knowledge that we learn, to do the ibadah as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded us, to perfect our aqidah, to learn the proper belief, to follow the way of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum and the early generations of Islam, to stay away from this laziness that we have and this life that keeps on just dragging us into materialistic things, but rather to do something for the deen of Allah and to do something that means for us to change and to be obedient to Allah and to follow the way of the companions radiallahu anhum and the early generations of Islam by following the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنا. They follow what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed. وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. I'm sorry I took too much of the time, and the snacks are coming inshallah. بارك الله فيكم. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward you all inshallah.